Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info. Scientists with NASA's Juno mission to the gas giant Jupiter are again reporting findings that completely upend standard scientific theory. A team of investigators studying the Jovian aurora have made the shocking discovery of a seemingly inexplicable electron acceleration process that appears to cause Jupiter's brightest auroras. A JPL press release on the discovery states that investigators, quote, observed signatures of powerful electric potentials aligned with Jupiter's magnetic field that accelerate electrons toward the Jovian atmosphere at energies up to 400,000 electron volts. But what is most puzzling investigators is what they call a, quote, unstable acceleration process that appears to take over when the auroras become more powerful. The lead investigator says of the findings, at Jupiter, the brightest auroras are caused by some kind of turbulent acceleration process that we do not understand very well. There are hints in our latest data indicating that as the power density of the auroral generation becomes stronger and stronger, the process becomes unstable, and a new acceleration process takes over. When it comes to the instabilities in electrified plasmas, the investigators could perhaps benefit from consulting the published material of renowned plasma physicist Anthony Perrat, who wrote in his book, Physics of the Plasma Universe. Electrons in cosmic plasmas are readily accelerated to high energies in the presence of even very small electric fields. In addition, the body of electron population which attracts electrons of less than runaway speed is eroded by the escape of electrons brought up to critical speed. If the electric field persists long enough, all the electrons will eventually run away in energy. The core concept that still eludes Juno investigators may be provided by Professor Donald Scott, who in recent years has developed his own original mathematical modeling of the structure of an electrical Birkeland current. The telltale signature of these currents impinging at the poles of a planet is counter-rotating cylinders in the planetary atmosphere. This counter-rotation is clearly seen at the North Pole of Saturn, in the earthly auroras, and critically, it is obvious at the North Pole of Jupiter, where one can see at least 15 counter-rotating cylinders. We asked Dr. Scott for his interpretation of the mysterious electron acceleration in the Jovian aurora.
And you think about it, Birkeland finally, many, many years after the poor man died, his work was absolutely substantiated by the probes that we sent up into the Earth's atmosphere, upper atmosphere. Birkeland was right that the Earth's auroras were indeed caused by electrical particles, charged particles, coming from the sun. Everybody knows that now, but this idea of spiraling, the twisting, the magnetic flux ropes that twist like ropes, the question I should think that they would be asking themselves, and it's apparently it has never occurred to them to do that, is why is the twist? What causes the twist? Everything in the sky twists. I mean, galaxies rotate, planets rotate, the sun rotates, everything twists, moves, but nothing sits still. Nothing flows like water in a pipe, just straight. Everything is twisting. Everything is in a tornadic kind of movement. And why? I would submit, according to the model that I developed, that is the basic fundamental property of a Birkeland current is this twisting, this counter-rotation. And that's where all of these motions come from. Apparently, they have observed electric fields out there. Mention of the word voltage, and we're talking about, and they actually put in here 400,000 electron volts. And they said electrons are accelerated in the Jovian atmosphere at energies up to 400,000 electron volts. Well, if it's an electron, that means it's gone through a voltage drop of 400,000 volts. That is a whale of a voltage. I remember being completely laughed at by certain astronomers who have attended our conferences in the past, and, oh, there is nothing, no voltage like that out there. I mean, where's the battery? You can't have, where'd you get the battery of 400,000 volts? Well, and now all of a sudden they see it, and now they're mystified, and had they listened to us and been more cooperative with us maybe years ago, more than just the 2 or 3 years since I published this model, but in years prior to that, and they would have maybe not been quite as surprised as they are. I mean, everybody should realize that the way you get charged particles, for example, a prime candidate, an electron, to accelerate is to put it in an electric field. To put it through a voltage drop, by definition, a voltage is a measure of the potential, the electrical potential energy a positive particle has at a certain point in space. So if you say the voltage at this point is 400,000 volts, that means it's just like a billiard ball or a bowling ball sitting on top of a 400,000-foot mountain. Okay, so now all of a sudden the bowling ball rolls down the mountain. By the time it gets to the bottom of the mountain and has fallen through that distance, man, is it moving. It converts its potential energy, which is voltage, into kinetic energy, which is, you know, 1/2 mv², 1/2 the mass times the velocity squared. So that even though it's velocity squared, that's still a pretty high velocity. So that's where they're getting these tremendous velocities from. And I think their problem is they don't know where the voltage comes from. I realize, and I think everybody who's interested in plasma cosmology realizes, that strong, very, very strong cosmic currents come not from a battery. There is no 400,000-volt battery out there in space. What there is an induction process when a conductor, and for the word conductor, substitute plasma, because plasma is a very, very good conductor. When a column of plasma moves through a magnetic field, or a magnetic field moves across a plasma, if there's relative motion between plasma and a magnetic field, you will induce a current. And given the magnificent size of these astronomical size of some of these magnetic fields and these plasma fields out there, yeah, there's a tremendous potential, and I use the word as a pun, tremendous potential. It's an induced current that gives electrons this tremendous acceleration. If we here in the electric universe are correct, then the entire cosmos, and specifically our solar system as being in the cosmos, is fed by electric currents, Birkeland currents, or at least force-free field-aligned currents, or some type of currents. We know they're out there. We know they're voluminous in their effect. If you think of an electrical resistor, that is a resistor in a piece of wire, if current goes through that resistor, there'll be a larger voltage at the front end of that resistor where the current enters the resistor, and it'll go out at a, what you can say, a minus sign, where the voltage will be less. So there'll be a voltage drop across that resistor. Okay, well, if you've gone with me that far, how about let's put in parallel, that is to say, connect the top of a capacitor to the plus side of the resistor, and the other side of the capacitor to the bottom end of the resistor, and now we have what's called a parallel combination of a resistor and a capacitor. That is a good starting point, I think, to think about an object, whether it be the sun or Earth or Jupiter or any other object that is under the influence of an electrical force, electrical currents that go through it. Let's not argue about the sun. We know the sun has those kinds of currents entering and leaving. And the same thing is true about Earth, because we know about the Birkeland current that comes into the North Pole of the Earth. So we know that happens. But if you think about the gizmo that's in the middle, whether it's the sun or the Earth or Jupiter or whatever, as a little parallel combination of a capacitor and a resistor, you can realize that as the current goes down through the resistor and makes that plus minus, plus at the top, let's say if current comes in at the top, plus at the top, minus at the bottom across that resistor, that same voltage is applied to the capacitor. Now, if you apply a voltage to a capacitor, that capacitor will charge up. It will have charge. And so can a body like Earth be charged? Yes, because it's within the current input that the Birkeland current puts in the North Pole. Actually, Birkeland currents carry currents both ways. There are these cylinders, and you can get current going down in the middle and up on the outside. Bodies can have charge. They do have charge, and they may have a net charge if it's hooked up, as I just described, with across a resistor through which a current is flowing, and there's a voltage drop across the resistor. There will be a voltage drop then across that capacitor, and that means the capacitor will have a net charge.
For continuous updates on space news from the electric universe, stay tuned to thunderbolts.info.